Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. Have you ever tried going vegan? I have. Whether you're 100% plant-based or a die-hard carnivore, there's a great deal that we all can learn from each other. And I'm honored to talk today with my friend Geoff Palmer, founder and CEO of Clean Machine, an all-natural vegan sports nutrition company. Geoff is a master when it comes to packing on muscle safely and naturally, with 4 awards in natural bodybuilding competitions and nearly 30 years of experience in the natural foods and supplements industry. Geoff is the real deal. We're going to be talking about natural bodybuilding, gut health, the vegan diet, the surprising benefits of certain types of weeds, testosterone, adaptogens, and a whole lot more. But before we get there, here's a quick note that came in from Devin. He says, "Hi Abel, I've read the book and I've been cooking things from it here and there. Right now my fiance is struggling with the typical diet means cut everything good out and limit calories to almost nothing mentality. I bought her a copy of The Wild Diet and I'm trying to get her to read it with her busy schedule to try to help explain what I believe makes way more sense. My issue is time and stress, like most people, I'm sure. Very busy at work right now, extra hours, lack of motivation to cook and grocery shop after work. I'm going to start the 7-day plan. This will help me immensely with my struggle of what to make. And if that goes well, we'll continue with the full plan. Oh, and I'm going to make some ice cream tomorrow night to help sell the idea. Thanks for the work you've put into food. It's a huge help. Devin." Hey, Devin, right on. This is so much fun. Yeah, you know, one of the best ways to get family and friends on board with this way of eating, we've found over the years, is actually by preparing treats like ice cream, like pies and cakes and cheesecakes. Cookies, all these things are very much a part of a healthy lifestyle, I believe. At least they're a part of, that was part of the deal with my wife Allison and I when we got into eating healthy together. We made the deal that we couldn't give up cookies. We still have to have fun eating this way. You can't just be a health nut eating chicken breast with broccoli every day. You can't just do that for the rest of your life. We have to have some more fun. So good on you for making some ice cream. Also, especially during the holidays, don't forget we have a whole lot of recipes over at fatburningman.com. Just check out the recipes section. We've got pumpkin pie. We've got homemade chocolate. We've got a lot of things. We've got peanut butter and almond cups. You can really make a lot of things without too much trouble, and it doesn't have to torpedo your fat loss results. So make sure to go to fatburningman.com. We have cookbooks, recipe books, a cooking class in our store. You'll meet me and my wife, Allison, personally. So make sure you go to fatburningman.com. Also, if you're looking for meal plans, we've been doing this for almost a decade, and we have more meal plans than you can shake a stick at. We have more than 12 months of meal plans that you'll get when you sign up for one of our courses. And you can check out for free. You get a 7-day free trial when you sign up for the Fat Burning Tribe, a group coaching community. So you can go to fatburningtribe.com, sign up for the trial, see if it's right for you. Check out some of the meal plans. We will be releasing a new app pretty soon, and it'll make this even more convenient for you folks. So in the meantime, go to fatburningtribe.com, sign up there, and I look forward to seeing you. And during this time of the year, it's especially important that you're topped up on the nutrients that you need to thrive. So an obvious one is vitamin D. We have vitamin D stack from Wild Superfoods. We're upgrading it to a higher potency, but you might not be aware, we also have vitamin C stack and fizzy C. So we have some of the best tasting collagen out there. We've made brownie recipes, and you can of course make shakes and puddings. You can put it in yogurt. It's called collagen cocoa. It's what we believe is the best tasting protein supplement out there. We've had a lot of fun with it. So if you're interested on stocking up, especially this time of year, if you want to get some for friends, we've got Future Greens, collagen cocoa, vitamin C stack. We've got adrenal stack to help you get through some rough times that may be ahead. So right now only in the US, but you can check it all out at wildsuperfoods.com. All right, on to the show with Geoff Palmer. We're chatting about how Geoff started bodybuilding competitions at 50 years young, the monumental difference between a natural whole food vegan diet and a processed vegan diet, natural bodybuilding versus traditional bodybuilding techniques, a surprisingly common and overlooked culprit that may be negatively affecting guys' testosterone, the benefits of adaptogens and how they relate to muscle growth, hormone production, and cortisol, a protein-rich superfood weed that you may never have heard of, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Geoff. Welcome back, folks. Today we're here with Geoff Palmer, founder and CEO of Clean Machine, an all-natural vegan sports nutrition company. With 4 awards in natural bodybuilding competitions and nearly 30 years of experience in the natural foods and supplements industry, Geoff is the real deal. Welcome to the show, Geoff.
Oh, well, thank you for having me on, Abel. It's a pleasure to be here.
Absolutely. So let's start with something that we haven't really discussed in detail on this show that I think is very important, because we have a lot of high-achieving listeners, a lot of people who also may have grown up in low-income environments and wished that they had grown up around high-IQ people, excelling, going to Ivy League schools and all the rest of it. But where you're coming from, your story is great for explaining how that's not always a positive thing.
Yeah, I mean, I feel, don't get me wrong, I feel blessed to be given the gifts of, and as we all should, no matter where we come from and who our parents are. But at the same time, being raised in a high IQ family has its double-edged sword. It can be an advantage at sometimes. It can also be a disadvantage. I remember reading, and please not to put myself in the same class as this guy, but one of my favorite guys who figured out Fermat's theorem, one of the great mathematical equations that has gone for hundreds of years and never been discovered. And he figured it out, and they asked him, how do you feel? And he says, alone. And he said, why? He goes, there's probably only 2 other people in the world who can understand what I just accomplished.
Yeah.
So that, you know, that's the challenge. And again, not to equate myself with some of the best and brightest minds, but, you know, I passed the Mensa high IQ exam, and my father was an English professor and a published author, poet, and musician too, played like 14 different instruments.
Wow. Yeah.
And my mother was an artist, accomplished artist, but also a psychologist, and worked with emotionally handicapped children, and wrote textbooks on how to work with children through art. It was amazing stuff. So really incredible environment. The conversations every time we had dinner would just explore all the amazing topics of the news of the day. For me, science was my thing. I loved, you know, Jacques Cousteau was my hero and stuff. So exploring the natural world was just fantastical to me. But, you know, getting on the bus and going to school and then having the conversations be about much different things, I found myself really challenged to try to fit in, to try to find some connection. And I don't call myself an asocial person. I really enjoy being around people. I enjoy talking,
yeah,
and conversing and sharing. But it was at a point where people were like, oh, you're the smart kid, you're the nerdy kid, we don't want to be around you, you're intimidating, you know, you're going to make us feel bad. And it's like, well, God, you know, I wanted to fit in and stuff like that. But I also saw in the world, a lot of people accepted, oh, this is the way you do this. This is the social norms. This is the business norms. These are what everybody does. And I'm like, but I saw the better ways.
Yeah.
You know, my mind said, no, you're doing it all wrong. And then, of course, when I present it, oh, you don't challenge the system because their whole business or the whole social construct is built on that. And if you pull out that peg, their whole system collapses. So they have to maintain that order. And I had a hard time going, if I know it's not right, not good, how can I be complicit in this process?
Right.
And then how can I fit in? And if the whole social structure and the business structure and the financial structure are all based on these certain structures, and I just don't connect to them, don't feel that they're the best way that human beings can offer, what is my place in society? What am I doing here?
Yeah. Yeah, and even the way that oftentimes we communicate with each other in, high IQ environments, like I went to an Ivy League school, it in almost no way prepared me for the real world, you know, like when you're going out shaking hands, especially with people who have been in business for a long time. And if you try using all those big fancy words and communicating the same way there, it's a totally different skill set. It's a totally different environment. And that can be very confusing and isolating, to your point.
Yeah, very. And look, we're social creatures, and we depend on the connection. And I didn't realize how important that connection was until depression slowly started creeping into my life. I wasn't happy trying to fit into that world in that structure. And I wasn't happy being alone either. Some people can find comfort in being to themselves. That wasn't me. So the depression did start to set in. And by I was in my early teens and ready to enter the work world and got through college and stuff like that, I said, okay, now what? What do I apply? How do I apply myself? And I started to get resentment towards society for being the way it was. And then, okay, but I'm not an angry person. I feel myself as a loving, caring person. That's not resonating with me. My behavior wasn't even resonating with me, you know? And I said, where do I go with this? And it started to implode. It started to turn inward. And the depression got to the point of just saying, okay, I don't belong here and I'm ready to leave.
And a lot of smart people are obsessive, I've noticed, in my own personal life and the people around me. You know, it's like it's not necessarily something that you're born with and it's like that and you're just smart. It's more like you have this thing that makes you obsess and go down these different rabbit holes and just like you don't give up until you're totally expired or you feel like you've really learned that domain or that skill set or whatever it is. And that can also lead to these negative states where you are depressed or anxious and you're just totally obsessed there too, kind of with that state or for whatever reason, seeking addiction or seeking escape. And so it's important that people realize, I think, that the grass seems greener on the other side, but oftentimes we're all struggling in our unique ways.
Totally. And to me, that when I had that breakthrough moment where I finally re-empowered myself and really felt myself coming from a place where, okay, now I realize why I'm here, my purpose, and that I can act on my purpose. It's not a world that dictates how I have to be. It's a world that does have guidelines, does have rules and laws,
sure.
And you do have to color with inside some of them. But there's a lot of creative room to play if you apply your mind and don't make others' limitations your limitations.
Yeah. One thing, this is to shift gears a little bit, but definitely another big part of your life, is one thing that I respect is especially people who aren't necessarily spring chickens anymore, maintaining just peak physical fitness and body composition, you know, continuing to set goals and reach goals, maybe exceed them throughout life. And you're an example to me and an inspiration in that way. And I'm not 100% sure, but I think we were at the same place at the same time for some of the natural bodybuilding competitions back in Austin. And it's inspiring. It's intimidating, but it's very inspiring to be around people who have in often their own ways totally nailed it.
Yeah, no, and it was an incredible experience, especially I didn't step on the stage on bodybuilding till I was 50.
Wow. That's so cool.
Yeah, so that was a great experience. You know, at first it started out a little bit like, can I do it at this age?
Right.
Is that even possible?
Yeah.
And then it was more an experience of, I not only want to prove this to myself that I can do something like this, but what a gift it would be to others, to inspire others that they also can do it. And that was even more powerful. That really got me, you know, the curiosity of, can I do this, was great. But if I do this and do it well, can it be an inspiration to others that could actually help them evolve, help them believe in themselves? That would be much more important to me. And that's really why I stepped on stage. Now, obviously, as a vegan, there was a whole plant-based element to it too, which is, you know, oh, you can't be a bodybuilder if you're vegan, right? You don't get enough protein, all that kind of, all the mythology around it that we now know is very different, since there's lots of athletes out there now that are plant-based and doing amazing things in all different sports, but including bodybuilding. And I just wanted to make this clear to your listeners. Natural bodybuilding is a very different sport than your traditional bodybuilding using enhanced techniques.
Yes, very different, but the physical results are maybe not comparable to that, but that, I mean, it's, you just become a caricature of yourself when you're shooting yourself up with all these drugs, and not to mention the health effects of that. So yeah, it's a totally different world, and a very empowering one in so many different ways.
Yeah, that is so true, to say that this is hard work and an eye for nutrition that got me to this place. It's body sculpting. It really is. As you take that little chisel and you're looking at every little facet of your body, I got to grow that a little bit more. I got to tighten that a little bit more. It's an art form, and it really is human sculpting of human living flesh.
Yeah.
And by choosing the work you put in and the techniques that you use, as well as the nutrition that you're putting in the body, you can transform the body. I know, you know that. You've done it yourself.
Yeah. So for you, especially getting the protein in, I've read some of your work around duckweed, which I hadn't heard about at all before you. Maybe we can just touch on that first.
Yeah, obviously, when I formed Clean Machine, it was to launch an initial product that I thought was pretty amazing. It was another plant that maybe we'll get a chance to talk about. But you know, I launched several other products, and people kept saying, "Well, you're a plant-based sports nutrition. Why don't you have a protein? You know, shouldn't that be the first thing you launch?" And I said, "Okay, so the vast majority of plant proteins out there are pea and rice blends. So the amino acid profiles are complementary to each other, and that makes sense." But I'm like, "Okay, but there are big players out there making it a lot cheaper than I could ever do it. And they have huge flavor houses that make it taste great." It's like, why do I want to do that?
Yeah.
I'm looking for something really unique, something really special. And I know that just like the plant proteins and whey protein, they're stripped down to just the protein mostly. Mm-hmm. It's about 80 to 90% protein. That means all the rest of the good stuff that we find in Whole Foods is ripped away.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, that's a little like Wonder Bread is being your base for your sandwich that you build on. You know, it's like, okay, because it's got all the fiber and everything stripped out. They look good, they taste good. It's not best for nutrition.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, how can I get my consumers, the people that follow our brand, a product that actually delivers health benefits while still getting that protein? Well, the reason that most companies strip out the protein is because it's much cheaper and easier to sell that and quantify it. But the second reason is because many of the plants just aren't high enough in protein. You'd have to eat a large quantity, right? In its healthy state. And that's why protein can be beneficial. Protein powders can be beneficial because it's concentrated, right? So you don't have to eat so many calories. And so there's some logic to that, but I really wanted something more whole-based nutrition. And then I found it, the duckweed. Yes. Called Glentine is the trade name for it. That's the commercial name for it. But it got its name from water lentils because nothing to do with lentils, the bean. It looks like a green lentil if you floated it on the water. It's kind of like a baby micro lily pad. But higher in protein and essential amino acids than any other plant. Pea, rice, hemp, soy, even soy, which was considered the gold standard of plant proteins.
Yeah.
Higher in nutrient density than spirulina, chlorella. I mean, even the top superfoods like moringa, which was considered the top superfood out there, it says more total nutrient density than moringa per 100 grams. It's incredible.
Yeah.
And what's amazing about this was a weed, right? We've been trying to kill it for the last 50 years in lakes and ponds all over the world. Until somebody was just like, okay, let's make a biofuel out of it, and then did the testing on it. And they're like, this nutrition is off the charts. We should be eating this stuff.
That's amazing. You know,
people say, well, if it's the highest in protein and highest and number one superfood, how you know, what scenario is it in modern society that we were ignorant to that for so long? It's because we've always considered it a weed. You know, we just never even gave it a thought.
That's amazing. And there are a lot of weeds like that, even up here at 8,000 feet in this sandy soil. We literally live close to the great sand dunes. It's high and dry. It's a high desert. It's very hard to grow here. And then it's in September and we already got a snowstorm, and our last one was in June. So it's rough. But at the same time, we've got a bunch of green wild amaranth growing. We have a ton of different berries, prickly pear cactus, just and not even to mention, we're basically inside of a giant pinyon orchard full of pine nuts, if you know how to deal with them and then extract them and process them, whatever. And so it's I just love that duckweed example, because there are so many weeds around us, and I learned this growing up with my mom, an herbalist. There are so many weeds around us that are incredibly useful if we just study them a little bit and familiarize ourselves.
It's a funny quote from Ralph Waldo Emerson saying that a weed is a plant we haven't discovered the virtue.
Exactly. Exactly.
And it is so true. I mean, I'm really glad that the research and the science is really starting to catch up with us. And we are starting to look at some of these plants because, you know, it's what up to 60% of the modern drugs today were developed from plants.
Yeah.
And that's where they're the healers. You know, they feed us. They've got the nutrients. That's what even to the point, you know, when people ask me, obviously, as a 35-year vegan, you know, where do you get your protein? And it's a funny question, because actually all protein that humans consume originate in plants. Animals don't make essential amino acids. They can't. It's impossible. That's why we call them essential, because we as humans, just like animals, have to get them from our diet, have to get them from outside of us. We can't make them internally. Yeah, we can break apart proteins and put them back together like pieces of a puzzle, but we can't actually create essential amino acids. No animal can. Bacteria can, but plants is where we get the vast majority of it. So whether you feed that plant's essential amino acids created by the plant to an animal and then kill the animal, you're basically getting the plant nutrients. You know, it's a little strange that we, you know, all the fiber comes from plants, all the polyphenols, phytonutrients, most of the vitamins come from plants, like vitamin C, not found in animals at all. You know, all of the fiber, all the macronutrients, fiber, carbohydrates, essential amino acids, and essential fats all come from plants, even essential fatty acids, you know, this, oh, you get them from fish. No. The fish actually eat algae, and that's where they get the essential fatty acids from. Fish don't make essential fatty acids. It's impossible. Animals don't make these. Animals, including humans, are consumers of nutrition. Plants are producers of nutrition. So it's really weird that we ended up feeding all these nutrients, micronutrients and macronutrients, from plants to an animal just to kill the animal and then consume the plant nutrients. I'm like, why do we run through a middleman? You know, it's not environmentally sustainable. It's not financially a good model. What model says, oh, go buy from a retailer to resell a product? No, you buy directly from the manufacturer.
I totally agree with you. There are too many middlemen, and that's obvious to see during, you know, times like these, to use that cliche. We live in a giant valley, and a lot of it is agricultural. Oddly enough, they can grow potatoes and things like that a little bit farther down in the valley, but they are burying thousands of pounds of perfectly good potatoes because of supply chain issues, because of too many middlemen, even though people around here are going hungry and starving. And that's a real thing, especially in certain parts of the rural Southwest. And so one thing I did want to touch upon is we live in an area here where also there are a lot of ranches, and we have yaks and buffalo and many ruminants especially, but then of course birds and all that. But I think what you're saying, and one place where we certainly agree, is that when you try to extract anything kind of out of nature and then blow it up and make it gigantic, you take it out of the ecosystem and it can't be a functioning organism in and of itself. But I was curious about, especially when you look at large-scale GMO or industrial agriculture of plant foods, it's not like every plant food is doing it right just because it's plants, right?
Totally. Especially GMOs. Don't get me started. But I mean, look, here's just some real simple, basic, high-arching stuff. So don't drill down onto me in the science space. But look, when our body detects, we're in an age of pathogens where COVID is obviously front and center. Okay, our body recognizes the protein of that COVID-19, and that's what we attack, right? So our body's immune system is developed to recognize or not recognize proteins, right? Now, when that protein enters our body and our body goes through its chemical list of, yeah, that's a food, no, that could be a pathogen. And pathogens can be bacteria or worms or viruses. Then it says, wait, I don't recognize that. That's a new protein. I'm going to go attack it. Okay. So when scientists start tweaking the proteins, genetically modifying the proteins of a plant, and we consume them, our body is going to say, I don't recognize that protein. I'm going to attack that. And it's no wonder we have this huge burst of autoimmune system problems that are going place right now. And it's funny. You look at the rate of GMO usage over time, and then you look at gluten intolerance. Oh, wow, they're almost identical. You know, in my statistics classes, we used to do that, marry up exact same charts, sure, and see if there's a correlation.
Yeah. Right?
And so it's funny when you see that. And it's so clear, especially with our huge new understanding of the gut microbiome and how it works and why it does what it does. It's all there. I mean, thank God that the research is now starting to look at our exchange, our symbiotic relationship with our microbiome.
Yeah. Now, another thing I wanted to talk about is sometimes, especially with the people who get like all into the vegan or vegetarian thing all at once, I'm surprised by how much they double down on sugar. And especially with your history of competition, I'm sure, well, you have to understand a lot about insulin, blood sugar, how that's all related when you're in competition. So I'd love just to hear you riff on that a little bit.
Yeah, so it's interesting. You take an apple, which is a great example because I'll mention it in just a second. So you take an apple and people say, wow, it's loaded with sugar, right? And it's actually low gut glycemic, which means it has a very little impact on raising blood sugar levels and therefore does not spike insulin. You're saying, well, how can something that's so full of sugar have such a little effect? And the answer is, both the fiber, which slows that amount of sugar into the bloodstream and attaches it, but also its polyphenols. So there are polyphenols in the outside of the skin of the apple, and there's a really cool one called floridzin. It is so effective at regulating the flow of sugar, regulating the metabolism of sugar. We now use it for a diabetic drug.
Wow.
And that's in the apple skin. So now when you remove that apple skin and make applesauce just out of the whole apple, now you're getting the sugar without its other components, and now it becomes higher glycemic. So yes, there is the prevalence of processed foods, I think, is more a danger than actually whether the plant, if you're getting a plant in its whole non-GMO, organic, whole food state, ideally wildcrafted or even grown in your backyard, that's awesome. That's about as good and as natural and as cooperative, because there's a whole host of chemicals that are phytochemicals that are in that plant that we are just disregarding as soon as we start processing it.
Yeah. And oftentimes, once again, we're looking for that magic bullet or that one thing, when in fact, like your example of the apple is a wonderful one. And the fiber combined with the sugar and the skin in that fully contained little ecosystem, that little world, and the microbiome around the skin, and maybe the worms that burrowed through it or the bugs that crawled up the core. It turns out that all of those pieces of life, they generally act symbiotically. And when you eat it all as one, it acts symbiotically with your system. Your system knows what to do with it.
Correct. And the microbiome is really showing us a lot of that detail. It's like, okay, the vast majority of the microbiome feeds on either fiber, oligosaccharides, or polyphenols, those three things. And then when you look at what creates a negative environment is bile. So pathogenic bacteria can thrive in a bile environment in our gut. Pathogenic meaning disease-causing or bad bacteria. And in a bile environment is created by high proteins and high fats. And you can get, obviously, that situation produced through plants or animals, but without the fiber, without the other things that would support the good bacteria. If you're consuming the animal products that are high in protein and fats, you're going to create a bile environment, which creates an environment more conducive for allowing pathogenic or disease-causing bacteria to thrive. So our microbiome is really clearly telling. Now, can we put in some occasionally? Sure, our body can adapt. What's amazing that research now is showing that in a single meal, our microbiome can change by up to 10%. I mean, that's phenomenal.
Yeah.
And within a matter of weeks, it can be in deep double digits, in a matter of weeks of changing your diet. So this is not just like, oh, it takes a long time and I don't have the weight or I have to eat all that. It's not an all or nothing equation. It's a spectrum and it expands or collapses based on that. So one of the words you're seeing in the microbiome field is diversity, right? And the more plants that we eat, more variety of plants that we eat, the larger the microbiome diversity. And the greater the biodiversity, the higher the health benefits. One of those cool things was on vitamin K. And, you know, there a lot of been out talk that, oh, vegans are vegetarians. Because we don't convert vitamin K1, which is found in mostly in plants, to vitamin K2, a bioactive form in humans that we need for bone health and things like that, you know, that was all the research was done, though, on the standard American diet, which is mostly revolves around consuming animals. Great study that just came out last year showed that when you eat plants, that fiber actually feeds a certain bacteria that actually converts vitamin K1 to K2. So there it is. It's right in the food. It's found in dark greens. It has the fiber. The K1 is extremely high. Like the vitamin K1 in duckweed, it's like 1,100%.
I got to try this duckweed stuff.
In a single scoop. I mean, you're talking a little amount. It's just off the charts at K1. But it also has 35% of your total day's fiber. So it's feeding that bacteria, increasing that number of bacteria that actually do the conversion. It was a misunderstanding based on studies done on people not eating a high fiber diet that they couldn't convert that. And it's true. In their place, they can't convert that. So, but if you look, there's a balance there. When you're consuming the animal products, they have K2 in them, right? So you don't need to convert. But if you're consuming plants, you raise your body's ability to convert the plant-based K1 to K2 that you need. So it's there, but we weren't seeing this until we started including plant-based eaters, plant-based diet in the research. And we found a very different microbiome shift when that happened and a different state. So a lot of these things that we thought we knew, like, you know, about omega-3s, you know, oh, you can't get sufficient EPA and DHA from plants, you know, because the conversion is low. Another study came out that showed that the highest conversion rates to DHA was in vegans. And why is that? Because our body adapted. They found out it was epigenetics. So what happens is basically if your body brings in a source already in its preformed state, DHA, preformed DHA, the body says, okay, we don't need to create anymore. We don't need to convert anymore. So it starts turning off those enzyme productions of D6 desaturase. And there's no need to convert it if you've got DHA. As a matter of fact, if you put in a lot of DHA, it actually cuts that off completely and your body starts building up EPA because it down converts. It converts from ALA to SDA, ETA, then EPA, then DPA and DHA. So DHA is the bottom rung of the ladder. Basically, everything converts to DHA. Why? Because it's important to the brain. Our body says, okay, let's give preferential treatment to the brain. It needs that nutrient. Let's make sure at the very least. So everything can down convert to DHA, but DHA can't up convert to anything else. So if you're only consuming preformed EPA and DHA, you're at rung number 4 and number 6 on the ladder. You're not getting any of the top conversion rates. So they said, all right, well, is ALA, SDA, and ETA, the first three omega-3s, are they important? So they followed a long-term study, which was great, 20 years, and elderly people from their 40s to the 60s. And they found the people with the highest ALA, SDA, ETA in their bloodstream. Interesting fact, when they tested people on a standard American diet, they had zero incidence of ETA in their system, none. They couldn't even find it. And the plant-based eaters, they tracked them all the way, and they found not only did they have higher IQs at the end of that study, but they actually had higher physical brain matter. And that was adjusted Wow. for the study. But they actually had more physical brain matter, more gray matter left with those higher rates of it. So yes, it's very important. And we are overlooking ALA, SDA, and ETA because we made all this super importance on just EPA and DHA. And it's amazing that, you know, we assumed, oh, that's what we found in fish, so that must be what's important. You know?
Yeah.
Not looking at, okay, let's actually look at how the human body works and how it functions.
Right.
And let's look at what happens when we put different foods in it, what happens. And now it's starting to unwrap a totally different story. So they found that when vegans ate ALA, which is the top one, right, their enzymes switched on almost into overdrive. And that's how they could get the higher conversion rates. Actually, they found the people with the highest DHA also had the most efficient conversion rates out of all people.
Wow.
So our body is amazingly adaptive to a plant-based diet, actually more efficiently adaptive than eating the outside thing. We see that with taking thyroid or taking steroids, like we mentioned before. When you take steroids for a prolonged period of time, our body actually shuts down its own production.
Right.
It says, I don't need to make my own. And that could permanently shut off. Same with thyroids. If you take a thyroid drug, like thyroxine or whatever, you